And I'd like to welcome our next speaker, John. Now that actually the topic of pinning has been mentioned in both of the morning talks and both forward referencing this talk, I'm sure that a lot of you will already be looking forward to the details on how pinning works in detail on Android.
All right. Can you hear me?
Yes.
All right. So sorry about that. Technical issues when you are using Linux and VirtualBox and all the rest. So yeah, I'm here to talk about pinning. First of all, I want to thank the organizers. This is like a very nice conference. I like it every time I'm here. I was here last time. So thank you for the opportunity. We're going to talk about pinning. And Nikolai and Scott already mentioned pinning, so we're going to dig a bit deeper. First of all, who am I? My name is John Kozyrakis. I work and live in London, UK. I'm like an application security consultant the last 6 years almost with Cigital, now with Synopsys, software integrity group after an acquisition. And what I do is I do mobile application security for mostly financial organizations. So I help them like design their application securely. I like talk directly to the architects and the designers, and they ask me like, what is the risk if we do like a custom keyboard or like a fingerprint authentication and things like that. Then I like do a lot of static analysis, like create engines and rules and all that. I work a lot in binary protections, obfuscations, assessing, reviewing commercial products that do that kind of thing in normal applications, not the malware side, just the commercial side. And I do some security research. You might have seen a couple of posts on SafetyNet that I posted, and some applications to do like SafetyNet attestation on the server side. So today we're going to talk about SSL and pinning and all the rest. What is trust? What is the public key infrastructure? What is the pinning? And the best part of the talk, I guess, is the implementation mistakes. Unfortunately, people that do pinning manually, customly, they do it wrong, most often than not. And then at the end, we are going to talk about the new features that Scott already mentioned. We might dig a deep deeper there as well. So your application is communicating with your backend, and it's exchanging potentially sensitive information, banking credentials, credit card details, and all that. You should be using TLS, first of all. There is no excuse not to use TLS. If your application is not having sensitive traffic, still, it's like 2017, you should be using TLS. Like, there is no excuse for like using plain text connections anymore. If you don't and you like are plain text, like any man in the middle can like inject traffic, like inject exploits, like replace content, track your actions, do like a lot of things like that. And believe me, like people do that. Like your communications are like passively man in the middle like all the time, if it's plain text especially. So TLS will offer you confidentiality, integrity, peer authentication of the server side at least. And if you are using HTTPS, everything will be fine by default and secure. Like HTTPS URL connection on Android, it's pretty, like, it's okay. Like, you shouldn't have any problems doing that. Now, if you use SSL sockets, then things are not that great because you need to do like hostname verification. We're going to go into that in a bit. Some more details on certificates. What is a certificate? I'm sure like most of you know here, like, I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this. So a certificate like is presented by the server, like the server has a public key pair, a public-private key pair. The certificate basically binds the identity of the server to the public key of the server. So like there's someone that is signing that blob, it's signing the subject, which is the DNS name of the server, and the public key, and it tells you this is like authentic. Now, who is signing that? Probably an intermediate certificate authority, which is like itself signed by root certificate authority. And the whole system works because every client, be it like a mobile application, operating system, a browser, holds like a trust store somewhere on the client side. And that trust store has like 150 or 200 certificates of root certificate authorities and other things. So that is how like the public key infrastructure works. And how this is verified on the client. So when you connect to like using SSL or TLS, the server sends its certificate back to you and a bunch of other certificates maybe. And it's the job of the client to verify those certificates, create a chain of trust, a trusted path, and do a lot of other actions. It's not only that. It has to actually verify that the host name is the one that you intended to connect to, the host name of the leaf intended certificate. It also, like, of course, needs to verify that the server actually holds the private key for the public key it presents. So it's like a recursive operation, not going into too many details here. So this is all nice and good for browsers. For mobile applications, not so much. I mean, it is OK, but like, think about it. Like, the public key infrastructure was created so because clients and browsers, like, you could connect to any thousands of hosts, and you didn't need, like, you don't need to hold the certificate or to know the certificate in advance. So you delegate basically your trust to the certificate authorities. But with mobile applications, most mobile applications, it's like your application connects to your backend, and like, you know what the backend is already. Like, you don't need a certificate authority necessarily to testify that this is your backend. Like, you have the certificate, like, you control it. So can you do better? Like, do you want to do better? So those are questions that your architects need to answer. And what is pinning? Pinning basically is a way for you to control the process of authentication. It's a way for you to, if you want to not depend on the public infrastructure and the certificate authorities, or you can still depend on it and raise the bar, I guess. Raise the bar above that. And it's a way basically to shrink the attack surface, because when you trust the public infrastructure system, you basically trust all the certificate authorities in the world. So pinning explicitly can offer you one type of thing and one type of thing only. It will offer you protection against certificate forgery. And certificate forgery is basically when someone like creates a certificate that is trusted by your system, but is not like the owner of the like private key, like of the original identity. I guess like someone has access to a certificate authority. And there are many ways this can be done, and it has been done. And there are rogue, I guess, certificate authorities. There are compromised certificate authorities. They have been in the past. Certificate authorities do a lot of mistakes, unfortunately. And there is like one corner case where like a user is phished into inserting a custom certificate authority certificate into his trustor. That was kind of fixed in Android 7, which is very good. So trusted authorities, are they really trusted? First of all, there is a very complicated and long, like 11-month process for a certificate authority to get into, to get the certificate into the trust store. And there are audits and counter audits, and then like you have Ryan's levy like on your ass, and like it's like it's complicated. And Andrew Black from Lookout has created like a report on questioning the chain of trust and a series of talks. And there he analyzes what is there really in the trust store. And he finds that there are like multiple certificate authorities that are directly controlled by governments that you may not trust necessarily, or indirectly controlled by governments. There are very small organizations that no one really knows why they are there, and feels kind of unnatural, like for a really tiny research organization to like have as much control as everything else in the trust store, because all certificate authorities are equal. Basically, they can all create certificates for everything. And you have the case where Android, like, I mean, there are some certificate authorities in the Android store, the default one, and then you have device manufacturers adding more, and like no one really controls what they add. CTS does some checks, but like they can add more. And one problem, another problem is that removing, like if a certificate authority has been classified as bad, there's no easy way to remove it. Like, you have to have a system update somehow, a full system update. Like, I don't think there's a way to remove it in Android with like a Google Play Store update or something like that. So it's really tricky. Android 7.1 has 156 certificate authorities that it trusts. And you can see like other operating systems, what they do. One interesting case is that VeriSign and Symantec issued a certificate, an intermediate certificate authority certificate, which means that Blue Code, the company that got it, can actually sign and create new certificates. It may be a valid case, but like Blue Code is a company, hardware company, that creates money in the middle appliances for network operators. So like make that what you want. And there have been many past failures in the PKIX system, the certificate authority ecosystem. OWASP has a page like documenting several of them. Like Global Sign was signed. Like if you follow the news, you may have noticed all that. 2 years ago, Symantec, some employees got fired for issuing a certificate for Google without Google's knowledge. And then a month ago, they did it again. 108 certificates issued, misissued. So that like depends on your, I guess, risk attitude as an application developer and as a designer of applications. Do you really care about these types of attacks? Because those types of attacks are a bit far-fetched, to be honest. They are not for everyone. And if you are really concerned about having a third party issuing certificates by a certificate authority that you trust in your name without your knowledge, then pinning is an appropriate control. And it can stop that, really. But it's not for everyone, and it's really complicated to do. So if you don't really want to do it, I advise people not to do it, actually. You have to be really convinced that you really want to do it and have the operational maturity as an organization to handle it, because handling pins is not for the faint of heart. Downside. There are a lot of downsides. First of all, it's obvious that certificate pinning will not protect you against if your pinned certificate has been compromised. So if you pin to a certificate authority and that certificate authority specifically gets compromised, pinning is not going to help you. Or if you pin to an end entity on your server, pinning is not going to help you if that gets compromised. And it will create a single point of failure. So if something goes wrong, or your users are locked out of your application, and there's no really easy way to, you have to issue an update and hope for the best that they update. Unless you go through the trouble of designing an online system that fetches certificates on your application and does all that, which is really tricky to do. If you get the implementation wrong, then you may break SSL validation completely, and all your connections may be as good as plaintext. And this has happened a lot, as we'll see in a few slides. And it's going to impact performance somewhat, because imagine that for every SSL handshake, you do an additional check, basically. So there is a performance impact there. Here is an interesting thing. I don't know if you noticed this. Barclays Bank is the second biggest bank in the UK. There was Black Friday event after Thanksgiving, and someone realized that all the users were locked out of the application suddenly, before the biggest day of the year, for purchases. And what had happened is that Symantec had revoked an intermediate certificate from one of the intermediates that it uses that was actually pinned in the application, and everything, all hell broke loose, and there were very senior people at Barclays Bank calling very senior people in Symantec at the same date, and Symantec actually unrevoked the revoked certificate and reissued against certificate authority guidelines, and it was a whole mess. It's all public, it's very nice to see what happened there. Also, certificate pinning is not going to stop reverse engineers. People that have local access on the device, they have rooted access on the device, they have FIDO exposed and all that, they're not going to be stopped by pinning. Pinning is not a control against that at all. Pinning is a control against remote attackers that do not have access to the device and can issue certificates. If you really want to stop those types of people and reverse engineers, you really need to look into binary hardening and upper detection, obfuscation, and all the rest, maybe safety data station even. So pinning has nothing to do with that. One last thing, what is a vulnerability? I have, as part of my job, I QA security reports very often. And certificate pinning, if it's bypassed by a local technique, some people report that as a vulnerability. It's not a vulnerability. The fact that you bypass certificate pinning using exposed is not a vulnerability in the app, at all. You shouldn't report that as a vulnerability. Absence of certificate pinning, is not a vulnerability. No way, it's not. Applications do not need to have certificate pinning. Now, if your organization has a policy that mandates certificate pinning, then okay, we can discuss that. But normally, it's not. Broken pinning implementations, though, those are vulnerabilities. So this means that the application wanted to do pinning, and there's a bug in the code. And those bugs come into two classes. The first one is there's a bug that renders the whole pinning ineffective, so you are as good as not doing pinning, which means that you still like have an SSL channel that is like correct and protected. And if the bug is particularly nasty, then you may break TLS validation completely and like your connections are not going to be secure at all. So you really need to be careful about that. Before doing pinning, you really need to sit down with architects and designers and figure out what it is really you want to do and which identities you want to pin to. Do you want to pin to the leaf certificate? Do you want to pin to the CA certificate? Like, do you want to pin to the subject K info or like the full certificate? How are you going to handle rotations, compromises, backups? Like, there's a million questions there. And I did like a separate talk on exactly those topics last year in OWASP, AppSec. So I'm not going to repeat that now. This talk is more about bugs and flaws and bad designs and very, very broken code. So let's start this. There's going to be code on the slides. A lot of applications do custom chain validation. As part of pinning, somehow they end up doing X509 certificate validation themselves and trying to reconstruct the chain. You shouldn't do that, like never do that. Like doing X509 chain validation is one of the nastiest and like extremely complex things you can do. You can trust like people that like do that in the operating systems and OpenSSL and all that, although there have been bugs there. But like if there are bugs there, imagine like what you are going to do. Like you're not going to get it right. It's too complex to get it right. So use the system support or a third party library that does it or OpenSSL, something like that. We've already talked about that. I feel like I shouldn't even mention this. So the way this works is that when you want to do pinning, typically you create your own X509 trust manager, and that trust manager gives you a callback that is called check server trusted, and allows you to replace the system chain validation with your own. And the way this function works is that it either throws an exception or it doesn't. If it throws an exception, then validation failed. If it doesn't throw an exception, validation is okay. Which means that this code is like always passes validation. And this is not about pinning. Like if you have this code, like your connections are actually not validated at all. Like they are plain text, essentially. So don't do that, not even debug builds. Like thankfully there are other ways to do it. Like if you are really serious about it, you should get your internal CA authority and like have that say, like your internal CA issue certificates to your pre-production environments and like have those certificates on the devices and all that. Or use a newer support in Android to like get away with not doing that. So let's go to real applications now. This is a payment processor. This is an SDK that applications can integrate into their code and process payments with a particular payment API. And this is one implementation of Check Server Trusted. And it attempts to do pinning. If you see, it gets the pinning information and then iterates through the pins and checks the pins against the server certificates. There are three different bugs here, like three different bugs. It's broken like in three different ways. It doesn't do anything. It doesn't do validation, doesn't do anything. So the pinning checks are there. First of all, it doesn't validate the chain, like at all, like no validation. Then it uses the chain object, and the chain object can have whatever certificate an attacker can throw at it. And then it only checks a specific position in the chain, but the chain is not ordered. Like it doesn't come ordered by the server. It can come whatever way the server wants. So this is going to break a lot. We're going to get into some more details later. This is a mobile payments application that many of you may have used. It's a very, very popular one. This time it does the system SSL validation because it actually calls the parent check server trusted of the system. So the chain is validated. And then it checks the pins, still broken. We're going to see why in a while. And this is a food ordering application, same things. It does the system SSL validation and then the pinning checks. Still broken. And this one even just checks the first certificate on the chain. Actually, it's not the first, it's a second. Like the chain is zero indexed. So like that can be anything. This is the OKHTTP library. The OKHTTP library, I'm sure most of you, like if you develop with Android, you are going to like have heard about it. It's like one of the most popular libraries. It actually powers HTTPS URL connection on Android. That it's developed by actually the guy Jesse that created HTTPS URL connection interface on Android. It has a certificate pinning feature, and it checks the peer certificates, gets the peer certificates, and then iterates through them and compares that against the pins. Still broken. What's going on? Why are all those implementations broken? So if you remember how the SSL handshake works, somewhere during the handshake, the server sends any certificates it wants to the client. The only obligation the server has is to send the leave certificate for the private key it holds, so the end entity certificate in CA lingo. It can send whatever else it wants. It can send like 30, 50 certificates. It can send the Google certificate, the GitHub certificate. It can send anything. A server, it's like totally in the control of the server what certificates it sends to the client. It's the job of the client to actually construct the trusted path between the server's end entity certificate and one of the trust anchors that is held by the client. So what is going on here is that the Get Peer Certificates API and the Check Server Trusted API that is powered by the Get Peer Certificates, that API is like a normal Java API. It's an SSL session API that actually gives the developers access to the certificates sent by the server, everything sent by the server, which can include whatever you want, which means that if you use that API to actually iterate through the certificates and check against the pins you hold, then like the server can actually send you the certificate you expect, and like pinning is not going to work at all. So like a server, like, and I have created tooling to do that, even like a custom option in man-in-the-middle proxy now supports like testing for something like that. So like you can bypass pinning. So bypassing pinning is a different thing than bypassing SSL validation, right? You still need a valid signed certificate by a certificate authority to do like the attack. Like SSL validation is not broken, it's just the pinning part is broken. Which means that if you want to do pinning, you're actually not doing pinning at all. So this impact, like we have found that in at least 6 US and UK very, very major banks that are clients of us, 4 like big retailers, 2 payment applications, tens of other applications from the Play Store, most importantly 6 libraries and SDKs that are used by lots and lots and lots of applications. One of them is OKHTTP that received a CVE, and I need to talk to Mike and other people from Mitre to get that sorted. Interestingly enough, 2 commercial Android obfuscation products that offer pinning as one of the features, like pinning was completely broken to them. So all of these have been contacted and are trying to fix their code. Now, I don't know what other applications are using, like a previous version of OKHTTP that is still vulnerable. And the fact is that most developers that do it without the support of a library, they are probably still vulnerable to this bug. And of course, this is like a Java API, right? It's not an Android API, which means that like all Java applications that use it that way to do pinning, they're broken as well. So it's not an easy situation. For people that like sequence diagrams, I'm not going to go into details. How to fix this? Like obviously, the pins need to be validated, and on the trusted path, the chain, the validated chain that the client is going to create during the SSL handshake, not the chain that is sent by the server. This is like really, really important. As we said, like the server sends whatever certificate it wants, the client creates a trusted path, and that path is like the validated and like valid path that you expect to have. You should check the pins only there, not like anywhere else. If you are doing a custom implementation, you should have a chain cleaning function, basically a function that cleans and gives you only the received, the trusted path, not everything the server sends. This is a really complex thing to do, so don't attempt it at home, I guess. Don't do it manually. Thankfully, since API 17, Android offers a way to get the actual trusted path from the system. That's the X509 Trust Manager Extensions API. It has like a different version of Check Server Trusted that actually returns the trusted, validated certificate chain. So if you really want to do pinning like manually without trusting a third-party library, you should be using that API and support API 17, that's minimum API. It had some problems that were fixed in Android then. Java, in Oracle Java world, things are a bit different. There has been a bug raised about this. The status is that it's fixed in the main code line, and they were waiting for a CPU, like an update, to actually fix that. And it appears that the fix is going to be that the get pitch certificates is actually going to return the sanitized list instead of like what the server sends. Until that happens, Java has changed the documentation. So Java 9 documentation includes that last line there, where it says that like whatever this API returns will not be used for trust decisions, like pinning and stuff. So that was that bug. And now let's go to other things. We kind of already talked about this. So you have this successor trusted implementation. It actually cleans the chain. It has like a chain cleaning function. And it checks the pins. So yes, it cleans the chain. It checks the pins against the clean trusted path. Does it do certificate validation? No, nope, doesn't do anything. Doesn't actually validate that this chain is like OK. So this is like the part that like is missed there. It doesn't call the original implementation of check server trusted. Other bugs, not really a bug, just like a misunderstanding, I guess, of what pinning really supposed to do. So pinning is supposed to like narrow and shrink the attack surface. And we've seen applications that replace the trust store, which holds 150 certificates, with another trust store that holds 20 certificates, the 20 most popular certificates. Like, what does that buy you? Like, this, like, I don't know what to say. Like, ideally, you should only pin like to the certificate authority that you want to pin, that is in your path, and maybe a backup one. Like, there's no reason like to pin like everything. Other like similar issue, like so, an application pins like wants to communicate with 10 different hosts and contains 10 different pins, and it checks like all the pins for all the hosts it connects to. Like, why would anyone do that? Like, you have to check like the pins like for the host you are going to connect to, not everything. I mean, time of check, time of use bugs, lots of those as well. So the application wants to communicate with a host name, like a specific host, and it checks the pins on the first connection, and then subsequent connections, it doesn't check it because it's already secure. Like, wow, like third time, like, yeah. So like, pinning, if you are actually going to check the pins, it should be done like on every SSL handshake, not just the first one. That doesn't make sense. Like, an attacker can attack the second connection and not the first. There are some slight like misunderstandings about caching, and like people try to do caching like similar to the previous thing for performance enhancement. If you do caching that way, code is completely broken. If you want to cache something, you should cache the intended certificate, not any certificate that you pin to. I'm not going to go into details about this. Basically, the attacker can include anything there. This is not really related to pinning, but it's like I thought it's like pretty important to highlight. So hostname verification. If you don't do hostname verification, like SSL is as good as like not doing SSL. Like, your application is going to trust a certificate for GitHub while you want to connect to Google. Like, that doesn't make sense. The first example like completely disables hostname verification, which means that your connection is completely insecure. The second one is more interesting. Like, can you guess what is going on there? Because I couldn't understand what is going on there. It looks like it's doing something, doing some check, but actually, like the session object that you should be like grabbing the certificate from, like it's not even checked. So I don't know what is compared to what there. Like, beats me. And then there's the allow hostname verifier. You shouldn't do that. This is actually a really interesting one. So applications are made up of multiple classes, multiple libraries. And sometimes they contain a lot of network handling code. Like it's different library, even by the same company. Like, it has like a library to connect to this API and another library to connect this other API. Like, they have their own trust managers and their own implementations of network handling code. Like, There can be one library that is using OKHTTP and another library that is using HTTP as URL connection and another library that uses something else. And we have seen applications that have like four different networking stacks like that. Three of them actually tried to do pinning. One of them was completely broken. One didn't even have pins. And the funny part about this is that the applications, the developers had the mandate to use pinning, and they were actually using one of the four implementations for most of the connections, and they were putting the pins in another implementation. So like not doing pinning at all. So that is that's not an easy problem to fix, actually. It's a very hard one. You have like to really know your code and like know how it is designed and try to like centralize something in one library in one place. And Android now helps with a new implementation. The fallback, the backup pins. So when you are using backup pins, you should really be careful not to like unnecessarily extend the attack surface that you have. Like you are doing pinning to limit the attack surface, right? So imagine this scenario, like an application has a normal pin to the end entity certificate, to the leaf certificate of a host, and then it includes a backup pin. But the backup pin is a pin to a certificate authority. Like what did the application buy by doing end entity pinning? Didn't buy anything. Like any attacker that has access to the certificate authority can actually like bypass pinning like it doesn't exist. Like unintentionally, the developers here exposed like the attack surface like to like a bigger risk than it should be. Like if you are using backup pins, you should really make sure to like have them on the same class of. So if you are having like end entity pinning for the first pin, you should have end entity for the second one. Like issue a new certificate that you are not using, and keep that like somewhere. Like in a trust store in HSM, like on your server side, and use it only if the first one gets compromised. So, implementation. How do you actually go about doing pinning properly? First of all, thankfully, since API 24, there's an Android network security config that Scott talked about. It's very nice. You should be using it. It has the problem that. Works only on 7 devices that represent 2.8% of the market right now. There are third-party libraries that you can use, and I suggest that you do if you want to do pinning. You should try to centralize the connection handling to one library. And the most important thing to remember is that you have to invoke that library for every connection, because I've seen time after time again that you use like a pinning library, and then some developer comes into the project and creates like his own connections without using that library. Like that completely bypasses pinning. There are some other ways you can like try to capture all connections through the application, like the stream handling factory. It's like flaky, it's not really easy to use. And it doesn't cover web views and other APIs, so it's really complex. Libraries. These are the libraries that you should be using if you want to support something before 24. OKHTTP by Square, by Jesse. Very good library, very efficient, very nice pinning implementation. Like poor Jesse spent like 2 or 3 weeks of time trying to fix that the CV earlier last year. There's the Net Security library by Mark Murphy, as Scott mentioned. It's a limited backport of network security config. It also supports an interesting thing. It supports tofu mode, which is like trust on first use. It has like a memorizing trust manager, which captures the certificate of the server the first time you connect, and then reuses that for pinning. So it's like an acceptable like risk if you want to take that. Trustkit for Android, it's a new library by Alban from Data Theorem. And it's pretty similar. It's less invasive than the net security. Both of them are a backport of the network security config to earlier Android versions. They are limited, so they don't support everything. For example, you cannot say that user certificates are not allowed because there's no API in previous Android versions to do that. And there is the Moxie's library, Android pinning. Like I'm sure everyone knows Moxie. So Moxie was like way ahead of his time. This is like before Signal and everything, 4 years ago. And it has like a chain cleaning function, and like as it should have. There are some problems with that library. Majoran is a GPL3 licensed, which means that you cannot really use it in commercial applications. So like, try your chances there. Don't think Moxie is going to come after you. But And the way the chain cleaning function works in this library is that it has in the library a CA certificate store that is a 4-year-old CA certificate store from a very, very old copy of Android in order to do the cleaning of the chain, because there was no other way back then. If you really insist on doing custom implementations, check server trusted. If you use it, like probably best not to use it, but if you want to use it, always do the cert cleaning, cert chain cleaning function. Ideally, you should be using the Trust Manager Extensions API, which is from API 17 that actually returns the clean chain, as we talked about. If you want to use SSL sockets, use the extended Trust Manager, which actually does hostname verification for you for the sockets. On iOS, like, be careful with that API, the SecTrust Evaluate. Some people were using pinning and OpenSSL libraries directly by opening the OpenSSL library of the system. That's like a very bad approach. It doesn't buy you anything, really, and you cannot even do it now, thanks to Nick and his team. And you can always statically compile OpenSSL into your application, and then if you really want to, you can make it very resistant and obfuscate it and like do tamper protection and everything and do all the connections using raw sockets. That's like a very extreme thing, but we have clients doing that. Web views were always a very, very sad story in Android, especially for pinning, because they didn't. You can basically, what happens with web views is that there are two parts to it. There's a connection handler and the rendering engine, and both of them live outside of your process, and you cannot really control what they do, and you cannot replace the trust manager with your own or things like that in web views easily, at least. The good news is that since API 24, the network security config works with web views, and I was actually surprised to find that, but it does. The user's clear text traffic flag doesn't still, but it will in the next version of Android, I believe. If you want to use pinning on web views in previous versions, then the only option really is to use the should intercept request API and capture the connection before it goes out, and then do the connection on your own in your app, using OKHTTP or something like that, and then feed the results back to the web view. It is possible. It's not without issues. Like, you cannot differentiate between get and post, and like that's like complicated. I'm not going to say anything about iOS. And we have some time. Let's go into network config. So new things. The really nice thing is strict mode. I like this a lot. So strict mode is something for debugging. You can enable it during debugging, and there's lots of options that you can enable, and it's going to alert you when things happen in your application. And one of the new things since API 23 is the detect clear text network flag API, which when it's enabled, actually there is a component in Android that does deep packet inspection on all outgoing traffic of your process and tries to match the traffic with TLS client hello bytes. So it has like the signature for the initial SSL, the first part of the SSL, and kills the. You can configure it to kill the connection or kill the app if that is found, or just log it. It's really, really nice. The user's clear the traffic manifest flag. You can enable it in the application element of your manifest, and that was API 23, and then it changed. It moved somewhere else. It moved to the Android network config since 24. You have to be careful with that flag. It doesn't mean that your application is only going to use secure traffic. It's a best effort thing, which means that the Android team has gone into the HTTPS URL connection code and told that code to respect that traffic. And always, like, if someone has enabled that, not do the plain text connections. And has gone into like some couple of other APIs to do that. And it has OKHTTP also supports it, and a couple of other libraries. But by no means, like, not everything supports that, which means that if you have like other third-party libraries, they may not support that, and you end up doing plain text connections even with that enabled. Also, web views do not support it for now. Hopefully, next version. Scott went into that. I'm not going to go into details. This is how it looks: the network configuration. You can configure policies like anchors and certificate pinning. It can be very flexible. You can have like app-wide policies, per domain policies, debug only policies, and it comes with some hidden features that are not really advertised. You can have a different XML file that is called, like if you like append debug at the end of the file, it's going to be a debug only configuration, and that is only going to work like when your app is debuggable, and that allows you to strip that configuration out from production builds. It's a really nice idea. I don't know why it's not in the documentation yet. HSTS enforcement, that is sort of coming along. There is all support that it needs to be, almost. You can configure it in your policy. You can configure it, but it doesn't do anything because no part of the code respects that. So you can do HSTS enforcement enabled, but nothing is going to change. And certificate transparency enforcement is coming very, very soon, probably in the next version that Google is going to announce in 2 months. This is the HSTS enforcement flag. You can set it, it's going to be accepted. It's not going to do anything. Web views support HSTS, of course, because they are like based on Chromium, which supports HSTS. Let's see if you want, or let's do like some a deep dive into how this exactly is structured. It's surprisingly similar to the PINIT paper by SBA. So the way this works is that when you create that XML file, there is a trust manager configured in the application by Android. And that trust manager is inserted into a provider that is set up in Java as a provider for the VM. And it's set up as the default PKIX provider for the VM, which means that all code that like wants to use the default trust manager of the application is going to use that. So it's like really, really transparent, and it covers more things that like developers do not really need to go enable it for every like library that they create. So it's really, really efficient implementation. A couple of like new APIs that were introduced. We already pretty much talked about all those. The network security policy class since API 23, the clear text traffic permitted. You can use those APIs on runtime to see what is going on. The is-certificate transparency verification required. That is there in the Android open source code, but it's not exposed yet. Hopefully next release. It's controlled by a system property. You can enable. There were some problems in the past when this was introduced, where applications were using reflection to change the app config, and so the network security config at runtime. That was fixed. This API, Trust Manager extension, since API 17. And since 21, there is also an API for checking if an actual certificate is provided by the user or not. So those, actually the way that those are checked is pretty simple, like those certificates go to a different directory in the file system, and they check like if the certificate is there or not. The Extended Trust Manager, we talked about this a bit. It's a new API in 24 where actually does hostname verification for SSL sockets, because there were so many developers like trying to do SSL socket connections, non-HTTPS stuff, and missing doing hostname verification, and that like is completely useless, it's completely broken. So now this class offers a check server trusted APIs that accept SSL socket or SSL engine objects and actually do all the checks for you. And the conscript like transparently supports that. And to like almost done, Apple. Apple has a feature called the ATS, App Transport Security, which is was introduced in iOS 9 before the Android Network Security Config was introduced. And I think that's where they, like that was like a major force for implementing the Android stuff. So the idea here is that you can configure the application to have policies and do things like block plain text connections, which is very similar to the strict mode on Android, but it's for production, not for debugging. And it's an interesting story about this. So if you enable that, by default, your application is not going to do plain text connections. So in WWDC in June, Apple said that this is going to be enforced for all applications starting this year, 2017. So everybody was panicking, like, well, like how do we stop like libraries and like how do we control everything? And then in August, Google, like in an official blog post, told people how to disable it, which is really interesting. And then a couple of days before the enforcement, Apple announced that the enforcement is postponed indefinitely. Like they didn't even announce a new like date. Apparently they figured out that everything will break and all hell will break loose. So that happened, and still developers are waiting for ATS to be enforced. And to close off, I guess, some ideas for future versions for Android Network Security Config. It would be nice if the policy file allowed you to specify like the ciphers instead of doing it manually. You can actually not do it manually because the trust manager that it gets created is not under your control, really. So if you want to enforce TLS 1.3, for example, like all outbound connections, you cannot really do it easily. Maybe we can look into runtime policy configuration. There are applications that want to configure pinning, for example, at runtime by downloading pins from their like secure host or something, secure backend. It would be nice if there were policies based on content source, like web views, like different policy for media, CDA transparency, HSDS, all those things. So in summary, we talked about how not everyone needs pinning. It's really complicated to do, and we didn't even talk about the policies. That was my other talk. It doesn't stop local attacks. You shouldn't think that it does. It is a headache if you implement it, so you better not, actually. If you do it manually, it's going to be wrong, most often than not. So use the Android Network Security configuration. Careful how you do it. How you like design your pin strategy, I guess. Like what, like you are using network security configuration, but what are you pinning? Like you have to really think about where you're pinning to. Or use like one of the third party libraries with the caveats we explained. Thank you very much. That was my talk.
Maybe just a quick question before we go into the coffee break, and then I assume we can also take questions offline.